God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Amen. I tell you, Church Family Thanksgiving is one of my favorite Sundays, and it used to be way harder when the food was beneath us, like right beneath us, before the Family Life Center was kind of this buffer, and before that, you'd just be constantly thinking about all those wonderful, wonderful smells that would be kind of wafting into the sanctuary, and it made it so hard to concentrate because it was sort of like your nose and your stomach were declaring war on your ears and your heart. And so it was always this battle. I remember that when I was a kid, but we're free from that this morning, praise God. The battle between the flesh and the spirit is hard enough when you're not thinking about pies and homemade mashed potatoes and all of those things. So let's let the Lord minister to us. And when I close, I'm going to ask His blessing on our food and on our fellowship so that we can head right down afterwards. Turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 4. We're continuing our series. We're going to be picking up right where we left off last week. So 1 Peter chapter 4, beginning with verse 7. And we're going to be going through verse 11. Time together this morning. So as you find your place, I want to ask that you stand with me in reverence to what God has spoken. This is the Word of God. These are the words of God given to us by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and we ought to receive them as such. The end of all things is near. Therefore, be of sound judgment and sober spirit for the purpose of prayer. Above all, keep fervent in your love for one another, because love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaint. As each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Whoever speaks is to do so as one who is speaking the utterances of God. Whoever serves is to do so as one who is serving by the strength which God supplies, so that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom belongs the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Say it with me if you believe it. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. Amen. Whoever has ears to hear, let them hear. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we have so much to be thankful for. And in this moment, Lord, let us be especially thankful to be able to hear a word from you. You tell us in Isaiah that your word that comes forth from your mouth isn't going to return to you empty, isn't going to return to you without accomplishing what you desire. And I believe that you've sent this word for your church in Flushing today. I believe, Lord, in the infinite complexity of your mind that you even had this day in mind when your spirit inspired Peter to write it. That's how big you are. Got a purpose in this, so I ask that you bless it and that you'd anoint me to preach it, and that you wouldn't let anything I'd say take away from it. So Lord, just grant me faithfulness in my calling today. Grant all of us faithfulness in receiving this word. Lord, beyond that, living it. We ask these things for your glory, and we won't leave here like we came. In Jesus' name. Amen. Be seated. We're drifting very soon into the Advent season. It seems almost impossible, but the reality is that when God took on flesh, that event that not only we celebrate really every week, but especially every time this year, the world kind of takes notice and celebrates right alongside us, whether they realize it or not. When God took on flesh about 2,000 years ago in the person of Jesus Christ, everything changed. Everything changed. So much so that since his time on earth, according to the scriptures, we have been living in the last days. Some people hear that and might laugh at that. Well, that's certainly a lot of last days, 2,000 years on. But the Bible actually accounts for that perfectly. And what it actually says to that objection is really pretty humbling. Lord willing, I'll be preaching that someday soon, because Peter actually addresses that very thing in his next letter. If Jesus hasn't returned by the first quarter of 2022, I plan on taking us there. But he begins here by saying the end of all things is near. There's two ways you could take that. Both of them are true. First, there's that redemptive reality that Jesus Christ died in the flesh for the sins of the world, rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, And we're in the final stages at this time in human history. We're in the final stages, the final time of God's redemptive plan. And so we're called to live our lives knowing that the end could come at any time. As the angel said in Acts chapter 1, this Jesus who's been taken up from you into heaven will come in just the way that you watched him go, meaning personally, meaning visibly. Second way you could take this, and as I said, they're both true, is that the end of the world is coming for each of us, even if it doesn't come for everyone around us at the same time, because all of us have an expiration date. All of us have this time that's known only to the God who brought us into this world. There is a time that is appointed for our hearts to stop, for our eyes to close, for our bodies to give up. In fact, the end of the world happens for at least one person every 12 seconds. In the United States alone, there are about 8,000 apocalypses every day. The end of all things is near. Therefore, Peter says, because the end of all things is near, because you know that, whether you're taking it personally or whether you're taking it prophetically, both of those are true, be of sound judgment. Be sober in spirit. This is really kind of a continuity of where we were last week. We were talking last week about an attitude. We were talking last week about our heart's intentions. Really, that theme is continuing. He's talking about our thinking. Everything proceeds from here. The Bible says, as a man thinks, so he acts. So if we're talking about having a sound mind, if we're talking about a sound judgment, it has to come from thinking on spiritual things. It has to come from thinking God's thoughts after him. Think about Joshua 1:8, famous verse. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night. We see that theme picked up in the first psalm, meditating on the word day and night. Why? Back to Joshua. So that you may be careful to do all that is written there. Then you will be prosperous. Then you will have success. It first takes that meditation. It first takes that thinking. Then comes the doing. If you don't have the thinking, you won't have the doing. We got to fill our minds with the word of God. That's how we renew them. We're called to do that. We need to do that. We need to renew our minds, because if we don't, what's left? Think about what it says in Romans chapter 12. If we don't renew our minds, we're just going to be conformed to the ways of the world. It happens. You don't have to try the other way. It's just going to naturally occur. If you're not filling your mind with the word of God, if you're not filling your mind with the things of God, if you're not allowing what he has said to seep into your heart, you will naturally go the way of the world. You will be drawn that way. I think we need to live in light of the reality of verse 7. The end of all things is near. The time is short, so we need to be deliberate in filling our minds with the word of God. So be of sound judgment. Be sober in spirit. How? To what end? For the purpose of prayer, specifically. And by the way, if you were to look at this in the Greek, prayer is pluralized here. So prayer is something that we're to give ourselves to, not as a sometimes kind of thing. This is talking about a constant surrender of our time, of ourselves in prayer. Be of sound judgment, be sober in spirit for the purpose of prayer. I want to take you this morning to a verse in Luke, a verse in Luke that's been staring me down since last spring. And what I mean by that is that it keeps coming back to me. This verse keeps coming back to me in my studies, in group studies. It's happened on Wednesdays, in devotionals and messages I hear. And I don't even mean messages that are necessarily rooted in Luke. I don't mean messages necessarily that are rooted in the return of Christ. I could just be listening to a message on just about anything, it seems like. And somehow this one red letter verse keeps coming back to me. What Jesus said in Luke 21, he said, keep on the alert at all times and pray that you may have the strength to escape all these things that are about to take place and to stand before the Son of Man. I was on my way to a prayer group in Frazeesburg several months ago. This verse was already on my heart. It came up again in something I was listening to. It came out of someone's mouth later in that day. It just kept coming back to me. Keep on the alert at all times. Pray that you may have the strength to escape all these things. He's talking about his return. He's talking about the same thing Peter's talking about, the end of all things. It's what Jesus is referencing. Just like Peter, I want you to notice that he connects that with urgency in prayer. In light of the approaching day, be more urgent in prayer. That's where Peter got this. He would have been there when Jesus said that in Luke 21. And I just want you to think about something. See, because a lot of people will look at that verse and they'll think, well, this is talking about the catching away of the church. This is talking about the Lord sparing us from wrath. That's what he means by escape. Okay, I'm not here to debate that right now, maybe. But question, think about this. Why would you need strength for that? Jesus says, pray that you may have strength to escape. See, verse 36 is a continuation of verses 34 and 35, where Jesus said, be on guard so that your hearts will not be weighted down with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of life. I think that's what we need the strength for. He's talking about a strength to escape worldliness that so easily can entangle us. Drunkenness is pretty self-explanatory. I think it was when Peter referenced it last week. I don't think I need to spend a lot of time explaining drunkenness to us. A dissipation, that's a word that, you know, we don't use all that much, but it's talking about living a life of excess, living a life of amusement, reckless, selfish stewardship while the world around us burns, while a lot of people don't know Jesus. That's what that's talking about, dissipation, wastefulness, and the worries of life. The worries of life, that could be 100 good things that get in the way of the one best thing. This is a word on priorities, really. We need strength to set them right, because if we don't, the Lord says in this same passage, that day's going to come on us suddenly like a trap. See, a lot of Christians say, Jesus is coming soon. We sang it this morning. Jesus is coming soon. I think most of us believe that, amen? Jesus is coming soon. We believe it, we think that, we know that. But does it make you pray more? Does that knowledge that he's coming soon, that this sky is going to split, that judgment is coming, that the nations are going to be judged, that the lost, if they don't know Jesus, are going to be the lost, not knowing Jesus soon to eternity at any day, does that make you pray more? Does the fact that you're going to stand before God and see him in his glory, does that make you pray more? Does it make you pray more? Because it should. Should. Jesus said that. Peter said that. Prayer is the way that we join our weakness to God's strength. That's what Jesus was telling us. That's what Peter's telling us. He's not really giving us a new message. He's giving us an old message, Peter is. And it's really a message that he had to learn a pretty hard lesson about. Because on the night of Jesus' betrayal, as much as it was the Lord's praying that strengthened him, you remember him in the garden praying for strength, it was Peter's lack of praying in that same hour that led to his infamous denial. In fact, Jesus told him that same night, he said, the spirit is willing, the flesh is weak. Peter, stay up. Peter, pray. But years later, Peter writes these words. We need to be urgent in our praying, and even beyond us, what about everyone else? What about the lost? What about the mission that's before us? What about the work that God has given us to do? In James chapter 4, we're told, we have not because we ask not. And we're reminded in so many places, you can't escape it reading your New Testament, so many places that God has sovereignly chosen our prayers as a means of grace in this world, that he's active through our praying, that that's accomplishing things, that that's doing things, that that's welcoming the power of God to be expressed in our spheres of influence, in our lives, and all those lives around us, that that's something that he's given us. So how are we doing with that? How are we doing with that? In light of the fast approaching day, how are we doing with that? Colossians says, devote yourself to it with an attitude of thanksgiving. I thought that was appropriate for this morning. Romans says the same thing, be devoted to prayer. I've asked this question before, I'm going to ask it again. Would anyone look at your life? Would anyone look at your life and think there's someone that's devoted to prayer? There's someone who prays like his life depends on. There's someone who prays like his job depends on it. There's someone who prays like the peace of his family depends on it. There's someone who prays like the ministry of his church depends on it. Like the lost making it to heaven all around him depends on it. Are you living that way? That whatever you pray for in the morning, that is going to determine what happens in the evening. Whatever you pray in the evening, that's going to make a difference in the morning. Are you praying that way? Are you living that way? And if not, why not? And if not, why not start by praying for the urgency of prayer? Say, God, I want that urgency. I see it in my own life. I'm not on my knees as much as I should be. I don't pray like I should be. I realize the reality. I realize the coming of Christ, that our King is returning soon. And I'm not praying as much as I need to. My mind isn't focused as much on everything that's around me that so desperately needs my intercession. God, would you give me that? Would you give me that urgency? Start there. Put that in my heart. We all need that. Doesn't matter how much we've got right now, we could all use more, because the weight of eternity, it is rushing toward us. We're closer to that consummation. We're closer to that return than anyone before us has ever been. It's a fact that's almost so simple you could overlook it. We are living right now in this very moment closer to the return of Christ than anyone who's ever lived before us. The end of all things was near for the first Christians who read this letter. How near is it for us? And then he says, I pulled the title of our message from the next two words. Then he says, above all, keep fervent in your love for one another. Why? Because love covers a multitude of sins. Above all. It means take everything that Peter has written so far in this letter. We're four chapters in at this point. We are 13 weeks into our series on Peter. If you add up the time, if you've been with us for every week of that, you've heard me preach for like 7 hours on everything that Peter has said so far. And he says, above all, above everything that came before it, take this thing and put it up here. This goes to the front of the line. This is our priority as believers, that we love one another above absolutely everything else. Love one another. Jesus said that's how anyone's going to know we're a Christian. The love that we have for one another. And that word fervent, it means to be stretched. It means to be strained. It's an anatomical word. This is describing like a muscle. Think of like a marathon runner. Chris Dowd's been one before. He did a prayer breakfast devotional on it, remember? I did a newspaper interview once where they thought I was a marathon runner. I made some remark about how I used to jog, and they just took that and they ran with that. And somehow I became a marathon runner almost overnight in papers. I still don't get that. But imagine a marathon runner who is running at full sprint. The inflammation in those muscles, the straining, the stress, the stretching that is going on as he's running at full sprint. Think of him at his most intense point in that race. That's the word that Peter uses here. It's the same word he used back in chapter 1. We saw this once before. It was verse 22, chapter 1. Talk about the love that we're to have for one another within the church, that unique love, that special love. We love our enemies, yes. We love them. We take the gospel to them. We humbly serve them. We sacrifice. We let them take from us even when it costs us. We let them take advantage of us. Yes, that is the teaching of Jesus. But there is something beyond that that exists within the church. There's something greater than that that exists within the church. How far would you be willing to go for someone who's lost that they might know Jesus? You think about the life of someone that you're interacting with. You want them to know the Lord. You know that if they die, they're entering into an eternity without Jesus, separated from him, separated from you forever. You think about what you would give in your life if there was some way that you could convince them, if there was some way that you could make them see the glory of Jesus. How much would you sacrifice? How much would you be willing to let them take advantage of you even? Consider whatever that is. Multiply it. Within the church, for those who know Jesus, for those you will spend eternity with, multiply. Don't put a limit on it. Remember St. Peter talking to Jesus, how many times do I forgive my brother? 70 times 7, Peter. I don't think Jesus was giving him a number. I think he was really saying, just keep on. Keep doing it. Keep going. Give even more to them. Love even more for them fervently. He describes that back in chapter 1 as something different even than our love for the world, which is great. Oh, but the love of the church. Higher, greater, deeper. We're all sinners here. Every one of us, without exception. It's a rule. You can't come here if you're perfect. That's the one rule. I say that in membership classes. We're all sinners. We're exceptional sinners, in fact. Sinners without exception, exceptional sinners. You're a sinner out there. I'm a sinner up here. 2 weeks, we have our missionary guest. I'll be a sinner out there. We'll have another sinner up here preaching the message, bringing the word. We're all sinners. Elders in this church, we're sinners. Sweetest ladies you know in this church that maybe you've known all your life, they're sinners. Most serving-hearted people in this church, the people that are always giving, always doing, breaking their backs for everybody else, sinners. All of them. We're all sinners, but we've been captured by the love of God in Jesus Christ. We've been drawn together as a body. God is working a miracle among us, bringing us together. And so we're spending time with one another. We're spending space, sharing space with one another, growing closer with one another. And what happens when you do that is sometimes we're going to get on one another's nerves. Personalities are going to clash. We're going to get offended even when there's been no intention to offend, or we're going to offend even when we didn't have any intention to offend. And almost all of it is going to be covered in just this way. Let love cover it. Love covers a multitude of sins. Let love cover it. Let love cover the cell phone, which is one. Love covers that. It's not even, we've already forgotten. We're moving on. Paul says in Colossians, as those who have been chosen by God, holy and beloved. First off, notice where he starts. You're holy and you're beloved. You're loved by God. As those who are loved by God, put on a heart of compassion and kindness and humility and gentleness and patience. By the way, all of those things are born out of love. That's actually why he goes on to say, beyond all of those things, put on love. We're to bear with one another. Forgive one another. He says, whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord forgave us, no exceptions. Meaning that if I'm able to look at the cross of Jesus, as Jed was praying, I'm able to look at the cross of Jesus and I see my sin debt nailed right there. What I need to be able to do is see that right beside it is my brother's sin debt. Right beside it is my sister's sin debt. It's nailed there too. His blood also shed for those things. And all that my Lord, who saved me, who came so far, who did so much to redeem me, all he's asking me to do is forgive them as he's forgiven me. That's it. That's all he's asking. That's the greatest thing that he's asking, was that you love one another. Peter says, above all, love one another. It's got to be grounded in love. Elsewhere, we're told that love isn't provoked, keeps no record of wrongs, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. And since the same passage, 1 Corinthians, tells us that love never fails, if those things are failing in us, then it's not love failing. It's us failing to love. We got to start over and go back. Wayne Grudem said this. Jed, you know Wayne Grudem. You got a tome on your shelf. You can knock somebody out with that book. Systematic Theology. If anybody wants a really long read, blue book, Systematic Theology by Wayne Grudem, he said this. He said, where love abounds in a fellowship of Christians, many small offenses and some large ones are readily overlooked and forgotten. But where love is lacking, every word is viewed with suspicion. Every action is liable to misunderstanding, and conflicts abound to Satan's perverse delight. And I think this too happens to have a connection with verse 7, the end of all things is near. We're in a war. The enemy knows his time is short. There's a passage in Revelation chapter, help me out, Justin, 12? Chapter 12. Satan is thrown down. Great wrath. Why? Someone have it? Revelation 12. Why is his wrath so great in Revelation 12? Shout it out if you know. Came down with great wrath because... I heard you say it.
His time is short.
His time is short. Isn't that what Peter told us? The end of all things is near? Makes the enemy busy. Makes the enemy very busy. He knows that his time is short. He knows that the end is near. We're in a war. Talk about this last week. Every day's a battle. You don't ever get a day back. That's a bummer. I've wasted a few. I could have done some way better things. You don't get any days back. The Lord's given us a mission. Every decision you make in your life, you're either taking ground for the kingdom or you are losing ground for the kingdom. And I think a lot of our defeat comes from unnecessary distraction, very, very simply. We fight battles we shouldn't be fighting. We're too busy to fight the battles we should be fighting. Sometimes we fight against what we're supposed to be fighting for. Not if love's covering it. Not if love's covering it. If we ever get there with someone else in the family, we need to stretch further. I know maybe that sounds overly simplified. It is overly simplified. And it's really probably the hardest thing in the world. You need the Spirit of God in you to do that, but we have the Spirit of God. Romans 8 says, whoever doesn't have the Spirit of God doesn't belong to him. If you're looking at Jesus Christ in faith, you have that Spirit of God within you that enables all of this. So if we ever get there, that means spend more time together, not less? How do we practically do this? How do we stretch, get together more? Jump straight into the awkwardness. Why? Because God's got a work to be done. Don't fight him on that. It's his prescribed way of stretching us. Never forgotten what A.B. Simpson said. Years ago, Tom gave me a book. It ended up being one of my favorite books, and then I gave it away. It was hard to find, and I had an eBay search saved for years, and in fact, I still have it saved, because if I ever see one pop up, I usually buy it, called Walking in Love. Really great book by A.B. Simpson. It's a short read. Bought a copy, and I'll never forget something he said in it. He said, when it comes to all of us coming together, he said, it's the Christ in us meeting the Christ in them. Life is touching life. God is meeting God. He said, that'll help you when you get to those hard places in the life of love. How does Christ regard your faults? As you would have him to regard your faults, so regard your brothers. Jesus is not looking. This was my favorite part. He said, Jesus is not looking at you as you are in yourself. He's looking at you robed in his grace. He's thinking of you as you're going to be when he's finished his glorious work in you. He says, so think of your brother, not in his present imperfection, but as he's going to be after the finished work of divine grace. He says, anticipate the future, foredate the coming glory, rise up to those heavenly realities, and receive them right here now as you'll receive them there. And with the heart and the eyes of Jesus, you'll look around you and earth will become heaven. It will in the church. I love that. Next time you're not getting along too well with someone, imagine the day that you're walking up there in heaven, it's going to come. And you're walking together and you're looking back. Whatever it was. Whatever it was. And you say, in the grand scheme of things, that was really stupid. If we only knew how short the time was. If we only knew how much work there was left to be done around us, I wonder what could have been at that point. Preaching is nothing if it isn't practical. Peter's going to help us. He's going to give us two ways that this love is going to show itself. First is through hospitality. He writes, be hospitable to one another without complaint. See, hospitality doesn't ask, how much do I like you? Hospitality doesn't ask, how much do I know you? Hospitality asks, how can I love you? And we're to ask that question, and then we're to live out the answer, Peter says, without complaint. And I think he adds that because when you're practicing hospitality, when you're being hospitable, there's always some cost attached to it. Right? Someone's in your home, someone's eating your food, someone's taking up your time. We recognize that. And in fact, our recognition of that can build up resentment if we're not also able to recognize that we're not actually the owners of any of those things. We're the stewards of them for a time, for a season, as the end of all things is near. That our houses, those belong to God. That our food, that belongs to God. That our time, that belongs to God. That whatever he has blessed us with, we are meant to bless others with it. There are things in our hands that are not necessarily meant to stay in our hands. He's intending that they pass through our hands onto someone else. We see this in Paul's words in 2 Corinthians 9. He says, God is able to make all grace abound to you so that always having all sufficiency in everything, meaning everything you need, he's going to give you. But it actually says he's going to abound and then he's going to give you more. Why? So that you may have an abundance for every good deed. As it is written, he scattered abroad. He gave to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. And look what he says. You supply seed for the sower and bread for food, will supply and multiply your seed for sowing. You need to give it away and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in everything for all liberality, which through us is producing thanksgiving to God. I thought that was appropriate today too. Blessed to bless others. And the result is the glory of God. The result is thanksgiving being given to God by those who receive the blessings, because ultimately they come from him, and they'll know that, they'll see that. Jesus is teaching the parable of the talents is that if we give freely, we'll go on to receive more. And at the same time, he gives a warning that if we cling to what we have, we'll receive less. In fact, he says even what we have is going to be taken from us. We won't be able to hang on to it. Hospitality is that giving freely. It's a way that love's going to show itself in the family of God. Hospitality, give freely. There's another way Peter gives us. Look at this. As each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. They're the gifts that God's given us. They're meant to be expressions of our love. Every believer's got at least one. I want you to understand this. I want to do a study on this sometime soon. I think I mentioned it in my last membership class. Every believer's got at least one gift. You can find lists of them several places in your Bible. I encourage you to look at that if you don't know yours. Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 12, Ephesians 4. Don't go there now. 1 Peter 4 is still talking to us. We'll do that later. Write that down. I love the phrase he uses here, manifold grace. The word actually is multicolored. You think of like a prism that's spitting out light and all those different colors. You think about like a quilt or something that's got all of those colors woven together. That's what this word manifold grace is explaining to us. That's how the Spirit explains and describes our giftedness. If you were here, you saw I was Bob Ross for Trunk or Treat. And I was sad by how many kids didn't get that. Their parents loved it. But he's on Netflix now, so I feel like parents, raise your kids right. Show them some Bob Ross. It'll help them to sleep, probably. It's stupid. But I was Bob Ross. I had this paint palette. I got it from Amazon. I remember when I got it, I thought, this is way too small. And I told Jenny, I said, I got to exchange this. This isn't accurate. And she said, honey, it's Trunk or Treat. It doesn't have to be 100% screen accurate. It's going to be okay. And so I hung on to it. But I think that paint palette is a really good picture of the church, that paint palette. All of those colors that God has on his palette that he's painting with. But here's the thing. You're not one of those base colors. If I could just kind of give you a way of thinking about it, think of those base colors as those are the gifts of the Spirit. What you are in the body is what he's mixing together. And that's unique. That's very unique. And so anytime you're not here, anytime you're detached from the body, it's not like we can just go and get another tube of green. It doesn't work that way. You're something very unique that God is mixing in the middle. In fact, I want to just encourage you, take the time today at Thanksgiving dinner as we sit down. Find someone who's not here, and maybe they're sick, maybe they're shut-in, maybe take them some food. It would be awesome. But someone that's not here, and just encourage them this week. Reach out to them this week. We're not just tubes of paint. We can go and just buy another one. Replace each other. When you're not here, it matters deeply. But I love that. Manifold grace. We've all got different gifts. That being the case, Peter's not going to get exhaustive here. I'm glad because I do want to eat, and that would take a lot of time to preach. Peter's going to sum them all up in two ways. Gifts of speaking, gifts of serving. Whoever speaks is to do so as one who is speaking the utterances of God. Whoever serves is to do so as one who is serving by the strength which God supplies. And categorically, if you were to go to all of those places where the gifts are listed in your Bible, they're all going to fit inside one of those. It's really neat how that works. Gifts of speaking, gifts of serving. I think that's what he's going for. First one sounds pretty significant, doesn't it? The utterances of God. Whoever speaks, let him speak as the utterances of God. And maybe we think about Peter. Right, he's writing this. We think about Peter in the book of Acts. He's speaking before critics. He's speaking before councils and courts, and he's declaring the gospel, or he's preaching to like 3,000 people, and they're all getting saved. We think about things like that. Maybe we think about Billy Graham taking the gospel to over a million people in 1973, South Korea. This is speaking the utterances of God. We think of something like that. That's true. It's included. Maybe that's where our minds go, but I think most of the obedience that's lived out of this verse hasn't been witnessed by crowds or carried all that far. I think most of the obedience of this verse is small. I think most of the obedience to this verse is seemingly insignificant. Not really insignificant, but seemingly insignificant. It matters to God. Country preacher no one's ever heard of, faithfully preaching to whoever few come anymore. I know a guy who's been doing that for at least twice my lifetime, and not a lot of people know his name down here, but I would bet you he's famous in heaven. Probably famous in hell. Infamous, maybe, in hell. Think about the mother speaking the word of God to the hearts of her children every morning over breakfast. Not a lot of fanfare surrounding her faith, but I'll tell you, God's working miracles through it. Lending your voice on the Sunday stage when we turn worship into music, or as a teacher, whether it's Sunday school, or it's Wednesday night, or it's one-on-one discipleship, those few words, maybe in a phone call to that lonely saint that you make, maybe that a few words in that text message that you send to that struggling saint, or maybe just that one timely word, or that one verse that's quoted in that moment of uncertainty or anxiety or hurt that you give to someone from the scriptures that's speaking the utterances of God. Love shows itself through that. And through our service, Peter says. Helps in ministration. giving, mercy, discernment, all of these things that we do, that we serve within the body. What does that look like? It looks like Jan and Joan organizing fellowship meals and funeral dinners and baby showers. It looks like Christy and Becky and Debbie setting up the Lord's table and filling up all of those cups and leaving the rest of us when we get to that point in the service just to take and eat. And it looks like Jackie and Yancey and Kelly even running the slide during praise and worship so that we can sing together, or during my sermons so that you can try to keep up with me. Looks like Shirley sending out cards that always seem to land in my mailbox when I need it the most. What about you? Looks like Debbie and Kelly cleaning up the building before service from week to week. Looks like Tom spreading out gravel last month or hanging up a door with Gilby. Mark and Dale snaking drains at 9 o'clock on a Tuesday night so the kids can come and hear about Jesus on a Wednesday. Jamie and Misty keeping them coming through the summer with their creativity, sometimes last minute pivoting when technology's fighting them. I've seen them do that, jump back into like songs that we used to sing when we were kids, or pandemics are changing the plan. They've got to kind of change the way things are done. Looks like Amanda Jane pregnant or juggling a kid or two, showing up anyway, bagging oranges at our produce distribution, sharing, paying the bills. Mike Lydon cutting the grass. Bill Patterson picking me up, driving me to Bel Air last week so we could load up 112 turkeys to give to our neighbors. Dalton helping us get them in a freezer, and I want to keep going, but it kind of feels like a Hebrews 11. Time would fail me. It would fail me if I kept on going. All of you. All of them, all of you, serving by the strength that God supplies. And I'm really thankful for you. And I love you, and I love this church. The result. So that in all things, God may be glorified. Through Jesus Christ, to whom belongs the glory and dominion forever and ever. What a difference it makes in our lives and in our church when that's the goal, the glory of Jesus, when we don't have any other goal. There's an unusual unity that comes in that that's impossible to find otherwise. There's a beauty that comes in that that's impossible to see otherwise. How many fires that puts out. How many impossible knots that untangles. And how many hearts that softens when all of us, with long-suffering sacrifice and with our spirit-giving gifts and saying and doing and giving and praying and being, stand side by side in love, in hospitality, as this word says, with sober spirits, with sound judgment in a contrary world. And we point to the God who entered into that contrary world to give everything he had for unloving people and inhospitable people and irrational people, because while we were yet sinners, the word says, Christ died for us. The goal is big, but it's reached through small obedience. And I believe that God will take this little church and do something eternal and unthinkable with it if we'll commit ourselves to just these five verses. And so I want to ask all of you and encourage all of you to do that with me and then expect great things from God. The end of all things is near. Peter said, the end of all things is near. The world is going to reel to and fro like a drunkard before it's over. The scriptures tell us that people are going to end up as rare as gold on the earth. Long-held standards are going to spiral and fall. Morals are going to be surrendered. Nations are going to be judged. Hearts are going to grow cold. And then they're going to fail with fear. I don't have dates on that, but I do have the details. In these difficult days, clear your mind for prayer. In these trying times, be fast to forgive. And as you see the door of history closing, open yours to others. Live like it's the day before the end of the world, and let it be a day where we all say, not less for Jesus, but more for Jesus. Preached every word of this passage, I think. I don't think I missed that, except the last one. I wanted to say this so that all you could help me preach it, because all of you have helped me preach it, so say it with me, church.
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, I ask that you add your blessing to the preaching of your word, add your blessing to those who added their amens. Lord, make this word to live in us as it's never lived before, as we live for you. Bless the food we're about to eat. We enjoy it all to your glory, everybody. Bless those that prepared it, those we share it with. How grateful we are to share it together and enjoy such a blessing at your hand. Everything we have, Lord, it comes from you. Our hearts are filled with thanksgiving because you're a good Father who loves to give good gifts to your children, and I can see that plainly in the faces that look back at me from this pulpit. I pray that every heart would magnify Jesus here. The breaking of bread and the healing of hearts and the mission that's before us. We ask these things in his name.